Amen. Amen. And God is good. He's good all the time, no matter what. Amen. 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 We certainly are excited to be in the house of the Lord one more time. And we call upon His name. We pray the Holy Spirit's presence in this place because we know that we are unable to do anything without Him. So we welcome the Holy Spirit. And you know, one of the things that uplifts and upbuilds my heart and my spirit is just knowing that all of His goodness, all of His grace, all of His mercy, that it will continue all the days of our life. Amen. The psalmist tells us that all the days of our lives, He will be with us. And I just praise God for that on today, that we know that His love for us is forever and forevermore. Amen and amen. Yeah. If you want to stand up with us, stand on up with us. Those of you that are at home, yeah, join us as we give God praise. If you're able to do it, do it. Amen. Amen. Forever and forever. Yes, His love for us endures forever. You know, we came in here to praise the Lord, and so we just start with a uplifting tune to give us a heart and prepare us to give God the praise. And so we just think about the fact that His love, it endures forever and forever. Amen and amen. What a mighty God you are. Yes. And we need to sing praises. He's worthy. Yeah, let's lift Him up. He's worthy. Give Him the honor. He's worthy. Amen. Amen. We lift Him up today. Yes. Forever He's faithful. Woo! Forever He's strong, you all. And He's with us. Just a moment in time, but forever. My heart feels good to know that no matter how dark the night, He loves us. No matter what's going on in our lives, He's right there with us. And it makes me want to sing praise. I know I'm not by myself. Yes, we lift Him up because He's worthy of all of the praise. Yes. When we sing praise. Oh.
Forever God is faithful.
Forever.
God is strong.
He is strong. Yes.
Forever. God is with us.
He's with us.
Forever.
Woo. Come on, y'all. Praise
forever
Him with us.
God is
yes.
faithful.
He's
forever
worthy. God, that forever He's strong. He has the power no matter what. Forever and ever and ever. Amen. What a way to begin this praise and worship service. Just lifting Him up and just recognizing that forever He is with us and forever He is strong and His love for us endures forever. That just gives me a hallelujah spirit on today. And I just praise God. And see, the reason that I need to know and that you all need to know that He loves us and that His love endures forever is because we always mess up. We are a sinful people and we fall short. Day after day after day and after day. But oh, we serve a God, you all.
All these pieces broken.
Yes.
And scattered,
it doesn't matter how broken we may be.
Mended and whole.
Yes, it doesn't matter.
empty-handed, but not forsaken.
When I just think about it,
I've been set free.
How many things he's delivered me from. I can't speak for you. Such amazing grace,
how
Lord.
Sweet the sound,
how sweet the sound.
That saved a wretch like
he saved
me.
A wretch like me, you all.
Oh, I once was
yes,
lost,
I once
but
was
now
lost.
I'm found, was blind,
I know I'm not by myself.
Now I, mm. see.
I just happen to be the one with the mic. When I think about all that I've done.
I can see the love,
the mistakes I've made, those days of disobedience, yes, those times of turning my back on him, he still brought us back to life, you all. Don't you know it didn't have to go this way for us? Things could have gone very differently in our lives. And no, it did not have to
take
be
our failure,
the way that it is. No, it
you
didn't.
Take our weakness.
I just praise
you
God.
You set your treasure in jars of clay.
Yes.
So take
in us,
this
you
heart,
are.
Lord.
He
I'll
pours
be
his best into us.
The world to see.
Yes.
Your life in
we was raised on amazing grace, you all. How sweet the sound.
Like me.
He saved a wretch like me.
I once was lost.
Yes.
Now
see, I know my story. You don't know my story. But I know my story. But we all have a story. Didn't make the best decisions always. Yes. There were times when we were just lost out here. And we thought we knew.
Raising up the broken.
If it wasn't for his grace, if it wasn't for his mercy, if it wasn't for his love, we wouldn't be able to stand and say thank you, Lord, today. A little bit of hallelujah.
Amazing
yes.
grace.
Amazing grace. How sweet the sound.
That saved a wretch like
he saved a wretch like me.
I once was lost. But now
come on, you all. Just think
blind,
about it.
But now
how much
I
he's
see.
Done for us. How much he's brought us from. I know we all have had times when we didn't know how the light bill was going to get paid. Oh, no, I know. There's always been a day, always been a time. But he's right there with us.
Raising up the broken to life.
Fixing us, putting those broken pieces back together again. And again and again. You know, I have been on this again and again for weeks now. That no matter what we do, he touches us again and again and again. And he gives us another opportunity to just say, I'm sorry, again and again and again. And I just praise God for that because Jesus died for us in spite of who he knew we were going to be. He knew us before we stepped a foot on this earth. He knew us. And he knew who we would become. He knew that we would struggle. He knew that we would walk away. But you know what? He still gave his life for us. He still hung on that cross, you all. Yes. He gave up a life in paradise for us. Oh, just think about it, you all. He did that for us. He paid the debt that we owed. You know, he never sinned. He never did anything wrong. It was us. Woo. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for giving your life for us. It was our death. He died. It should have been us. Ah, come on now. It should have been us. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to you, Lord. Yes. Yes. And I had a whole lot and still do have a whole lot to be shame about. Those thoughts that we have that we know we should not have shame. The words that we speak that we know we shouldn't utter shame. Oh, the places we go that we know we don't have no business at, shame. My sin, he erased. Hallelujah. He wiped the slate clean for us so that we could start over again and again. Oh. Woo. No greater love.
There is no greater love.
There is no greater love. He loves us so. Yes. Yes, thank you, Lord.
There is no
hallelujah. We have to say thank you, Lord. That's the least
there
we could do.
No
because of his love for us.
There is no
hallelujah. There is no greater love
than my Savior.
Yes. And I just praise God that he lifted up. Glory to your name, Lord. Yes. The Lamb of God.
In my place. Your
yes. Hallelujah.
My sin.
Makes you just want to shout your shout. Just makes you want to dance your dance. Because he's so good. He's the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. Give him the praise that he is deserving of today. Lift him up. Yes. Yes. My death, he died. And I've been raised to life, you all. He snatched me. I can't speak for you, see, because this is my own praise. He snatched me out of the pit of hell. And for that, I will forever be grateful. Don't you know? We owe him so much. And the least we could do is say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, because he is an awesome God. And I am just excited to have an opportunity to stand here on this day at this time and honor him. And I know in your hearts and in your spirits, you're doing the same. You're taking a moment out of your busy Saturday, and you are praising and worshiping him because he's worthy, you all. He's worthy. And in it all of the glory, the honor, the majesty, it belongs to him. It has nothing to do with us, but it is all his. Woo! Glory. Thank you, Lord.
I can't take credit.
You know, we quick to steal his credit.
For the breath in these lungs,
we so good, we so kind, we so perfect because of us, but it's nothing to do with us.
His heart's a vessel.
Who is because of him?
And the love that
and we can't take credit for it.
Let it be sweet perfume poured out on me. I give you the glory. All of the glory, I give
yes,
you the
yes,
glory.
Come on. again and again. This praise isn't for me.
My worship is only
it is because of you, Lord. Because of your grace, your kindness, your mercy, your sacrifice. Ah, thank you, Lord.
There's only one name.
Thank you, Lord. Sometimes when you're out, you just need to shout Jesus. You're in the store, you got money to pay your bill. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Because there's power in his name. Yes. So yeah, we need to practice shouting the name of Jesus. Giving him the glory that he deserves. Yes, yes, yes.
Again and again. This praise
hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
My worship is only to give you the glory forever. Amen. Forever.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
I love this because it reminds me that we're nothing without him. We would have nothing without him. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, every moment of my life,
yeah,
I'm gonna give you praise.
Every moment of our lives, we need to give him the praise.
In everything I am,
everything
in
that
everything
I am,
I do, Lord, the glory belongs
to you.
Nothing
to do with how much school we got, how much education we got, how much money we got. No, it's because of him. And we need to give him the honor and glory that he deserves. Keeping my daughter. Thank you, Lord.
The glory belongs to you.
Because it just didn't have to be you all. We take so much for granted. Brother, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
So when I give you praise, when I speak your name, Lord,
for wrapping your arms around my aunt, thank you, Lord.
All the glory belongs to you. All the glory belongs to you.
It has nothing to do with me.
All the glory belongs to you.
It's all about you, Lord.
All the glory,
all of the glory,
it belongs to you.
It belongs to him. He is such a good God. And he's there when we can't be, you all. For those people that we love so dear, he's there when we can't be. And that is praiseworthy, you all. Don't take it for granted that they're going to go to bed at night and wake up in the morning. Don't take that for granted. It is because of who he is. And I just can't praise him enough, you all. I can't praise him enough. And I know I'm not by myself when I say it. And so we just give you the glory, Lord. We give you the glory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It's giving time. If you want to give, now is the time to give. We have trays in the front, and those of you that are at home, you know that you are welcome to give through our electronic giving format, tithe.ly.com. And certainly, we appreciate all gifts, and we praise God for you. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, Lord, just thanking you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, because you are there with us, come what may. Heavenly Father, we thank you because during those times of struggle, the times of hurt and pain, you're right there. Heavenly Father, we know that there are some right now that are going through hard times. They're facing hard times financially. Lord, we pray that on this day you would send an angel of relief into their lives. Just give them a moment, Heavenly Father, to be able to take a deep breath and know that everything is going to be all right. Heavenly Father, there are some out there who are going through losses of good health. The doctors have told them they have days and weeks, months, and maybe a year to live. But Lord, you are the supreme doctor. And so we call on you right now and pray that you would touch them right where they are. And cause them to be encouraged in knowing that your word remains just as true today as when it was said to Joshua, you will never leave us and you will never forsake us. And we just thank you for that on today. Ha! Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Oh, yes, Heavenly Father, our prayer is that you indeed would allow your Holy Spirit to minister to all who are under the sound of my voice in whatever manner they deem necessary in their lives. Whatever they're going through, touch. Whatever they're thinking or feeling, touch. Oh, yes, Lord, you are not a gossip, and I may not know everything that's going on with every person, but I know that you know. And so I just call on you to touch as only you can. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that those who have given, that you would bless their gifts, that you would multiply them, and that indeed, Heavenly Father, you would cause them to be multiplied in their lives. And that, Heavenly Father, it may not be money, it may be a good night's sleep. We say thank you. Thank you for blessing because of our faithfulness. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. 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 All right, it's time for our sermonic message. And the sermonic message for today comes from 1 Corinthians, the 8th chapter, the 10th through the 13th verses. That's 1 Corinthians, the 8th chapter, the 10th through the 13th verses. For if others see you who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their falling, I will never eat meat, so that I may not cause one of them to fall. Amen and amen. Quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, allow this word to be a blessing. Allow it to touch the lives of these people in the way that it's already touched my life and been a blessing unto me. In your name, Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Amen. Now, one thing I know for certain on today is that somebody needs to hear this message. And the reason I know that is because I have my scripture and topic set for every Saturday and Sunday well in advance. As I've told you all in times past, I put together this schedule starting somewhere around October. I'm usually done by the end of the year. And I lay out scripture and subject that I'm going to preach for each Saturday and each Sunday. And it's rare for me to change it. I mean, it is rare for me to change it. Because one of the things that I've learned, and one of my preaching friends asked me about it, but one of the things that I've learned is that the Holy Spirit is present in the putting together of the schedule. Because what I have been asked in times past is, well, what do you do when things are going on? You know, how can you know ahead of time what you need to, what the people are going to need that week? Well, the easy answer is I don't. I don't know what the people need to hear, but the Holy Spirit does. And he runs out ahead of me, and he gives me topics and scriptures and verses and subjects of sermons. And I stick with it, but not this week. Not this week. It was amazing how it happened. And because I went to my notes to get ready to start my sermon prep on Monday of this week, and I wrote down a scripture. And then a few days later, I went back to it to start working up the sermon. And what I found is that the scripture I wrote down was not the scripture that was in my preaching schedule. Now, what was I going to do? Because now I had been put in a situation where, for some reason, I wrote down 1 Corinthians 8, 10 through 13 instead of the scripture that was on my preaching calendar to preach. And so, since I never change it, I had an option. Scratch this out and put the sermon that I had already intended to preach and start preparing that sermon. Or I could listen to the Holy Spirit, who does not make mistakes. And I said, the fact that I wrote this scripture down wherever I got it from tells me that I and many others need to hear this message on today. So that's how I know that this message is for all of us, and it's a special hand-delivered message from God. The subject of today's sermonic message, they see us. Mm-hmm. They see us. Whew. At the end of the day, you all, this message is about love. It's about our love for one another. And I know at first look, at first hearing of this text, it's hard to believe that I'm going to some way, somehow get back around to love. But you just watch how God moves. Because God told us, and he continues to tell us, that we must have love for others. We just have to have love for others. And that love that we're tasked as Christians to have for others includes our showing them love in various ways. And we show that love in what we think, first and foremost. And I know nobody knows what we're thinking but us. So we need to do some self-reflection, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. Are our thoughts thoughts of love? When we look at that person who's standing out on the corner with a sign that says, "We'll work for food," is our thought a thought of love? I didn't say whether you helped them or not. That's not what I said. I said, are our thoughts thought of love? So we need to clean that up and put ourselves in a position to have our thoughts be thoughts that are love-filled. And what about the things we say? Boy, I tell you, The words that come out of our mouths, are they words of love? I believe this to my core, and I made it a practice in my marriage. Be careful what you say in the midst of a heated argument, because you can never take it back. Mm-mm. No, once you say it, you have said it. And they heard you say it. Now, when you cool off, you're going to say, I'm sorry and I didn't mean it. Mm-mm. You meant exactly what you said. You were angry when you said it and it spilled out. You can't take that back. The person may forgive you, but you cannot take back the damage that was done with the words that we have spoken. So there was many a day that we did have an argument that I stopped myself from saying what I was getting ready to say, because there was no coming back from it once you said it. Words of love, you all. And what about the things that we do? As Christians, the things that we do should be done in love. And certainly there are many a thing that we do that has nothing to do with love. Mm-mm. You see, because sometimes we get caught up into thinking that the love that we show can only be shown in the good works that we do. You know, we give to the homeless people, we give food to the shelters, you know, so we clean and we clear. Mm-mm. Good deeds are not enough. The love we have as Christians that we're supposed to have for others, it goes so much further than that. And it's shown in how we live our lives, how we live our lives. People are always watching. Never forget that. Ooh. I'm messing with me today too, you all. I done moved from a big city to this little bitty town. I can't go nowhere. I can't do nothing. People know exactly who I am. My face be all around the newspaper, and people know who you are. The town just too small. So I can't get mad at the dry cleaners and go to cussing people out. Yeah. See, where I come from, I could do almost anything. It's a big city. But oh my, the tide has turned. Amen. People are always watching. Never forget that. But not only are people watching, we should be watching ourselves. And we need to take a look in the mirror and determine who we see looking back at us. I didn't say who we think we see. None of us look like Beyonce. Stop it. So I'm not talking about what we think we see. I'm talking about being real today. Are we nice people? We like to claim to be, but are we really? Are we really? Are we caring people? Is that who we see when we look in the mirror? Do we see a person who's caring? Are we respectful of other people? I'm just talking about basic respect, you all. It is disrespectful to step in front of somebody else in the line at the grocery store. It's disrespectful to get into the 12 and under line and you know you got 30 items. I'm just talking about basic respect here, you all. And I'm giving simple examples because some of us get too upset when I give the real ones. Were you being respectful when you told that person to shut up? Is that being respectful? Were you being respectful when you was talking about the pastor at dinner? You had plenty to say about what he or she is and isn't doing, and you not doing nothing. Nothing but talking. Is that being respectful? Who are we? When we look in the mirror, who are we? And one thing we have to come to understand is that when we look in the mirror, whoever we see, others around us see a person that is so much more than what we see. Let me explain that. Because other people, They see the person that we don't want to admit that we are. They see the person that we don't want to admit that we are. A person who is even more imperfect than we thought we were. Because, you know, we think we got it together. But they see us, you all. They see us. I am not saying any of this to cause us as Christians to feel bad. Because Satan is a liar. And there is no condemnation in those that love Christ. I'm just shining a light so we can know what we need to be praying about. Amen. Amen. We don't need to down ourselves because of our shortcomings. But just know that when others are looking at us, we do need to actually consider who it is they're seeing. And we need to do something about it. If we recognize that who they see is not a Christian, then we need to fix that thing. Because they see us as a person who just knows better. You know, these people are watching us. We always talking about we love the Lord. And they see us. And they see us as a person who knows better. And not that they see us as being perfect. That's not reasonable. Not that they see us as being just so smart or so intelligent. That's not reasonable. But just that we know better. And nothing that we said causes people to see us in this manner. But just know that as saved children of God, we command a certain amount of respect when we walk into a room. That people might have been saying and doing something before we walked in, and then we walk in and the atmosphere shifts. Or at least it should. Because they see us coming. They see us coming and they know that we're a people who should know better. And people can just tell that there is something different about us. And for that reason, because they think that we know better, they're watching. Never forget that. They are watching. And they're expecting us not to say certain things. They're expecting us not to do certain things. And certainly, I'm going to come back around to that. So these people, they see us. They see us as people who are wise. That we're equipped to make good decisions, you all. So don't you know if they see us do it, they think it's okay. Because we're wise. I'm putting a lot of heavy weight on a Christian today, you all. But that's why we need the Holy Spirit. Because it is a heavy load to carry. But you know, we have a requirement. We have responsibilities. We know the difference between right and wrong. At least that's what people that see us think and believe. That's who they see. Yeah. They come to believe that they can trust our words and our actions over others. I went to a grief group after my husband passed away, because I needed a little bit of help wrestling with the fact that my 50-year-old husband was gone far too soon and that I didn't have a husband anymore. And when I went to that grief group, they never put pressure on you to talk, but when the subject of employment would, first of all, I went two or three towns away. There are grief groups in our backyard here in Pennsylvania. Right here, not too far, over in Natrona Heights, and I'm in Tarentum. I didn't go there because I know them people, and I didn't want to run into my members at the grief group. So I went two towns over, and whenever the subject came up as to employment, I would say I'm a lawyer. Those of you out there at home shaking your head, no, it was not a lie. I am a lawyer, and I do still practice law in Michigan and Pennsylvania, but I'm a full-time pastor. I dabble. I don't do it as a profession anymore. I dabble, depends on who asks me. So it's not a lie for me to say I'm a lawyer. But never once did I tell them, never once. They found out a year in, because somebody outed me at the meeting. They followed me on Facebook and saw it. But I never said that I was a pastor, but here's why. Because people are always watching. Never forget that. And if the video they showed, which was always full of scriptures, it was a godly group. If I disagreed with what it said, I didn't want it to be the pastor disagrees with what it says. I didn't want it to be the pastor is wrestling with the death of her husband. I didn't want it to be the pastor said she having a hard time. No. Because I got it that people see me as being wise and knowing the difference between right and wrong and able to make good decisions. And because I know that they saw me that way, I never wanted my words or actions to cause one of them to fall. That's all Paul was talking about. If you know that what you're doing will cause your brother or sister to fall, then don't do it. Even though you can do it, don't do it. These people see us as being saved children of God. And this is important because how we live our lives represents God. When people see us, they see Him, whether you want them to or not. When they see us, they see Him. We have to accept that. We need to listen to the Holy Spirit, and that's the only way that we can hold up to the scrutiny that we are under as Christians. So we're seen as people that make moral choices, people that make God-approved choices, people whose choices are worthy of being followed. Yeah. That's who they see. But what is it that they see? That's who they see, but what do they see? Because this text not only tells us about the importance of who people see when they look at us, but it also tells us a little bit about what they see. When they look at us, what do they see? So let's continue to be honest with ourselves on today. Prayerfully, and I say prayerfully. Most times when people see us, they see the good that we do. They hear the good that we say. They watch the good manner in which we live. That truly is our hope on today. And as Christians, it should be the case. But people are watching. Never forget that. And sometimes, as unfortunate as it is, when they see us, people absolutely see us doing things that we as Christians have been taught not to do. You know that we've been taught. Yeah, you know, when it benefits us, we lie, but we've been taught not to be a liar. Mm-hmm. We lie to keep from losing our jobs. Shoot, the preacher, pastor, a lie to keep from losing their church. Oh, we'll tell a lie. We'll tell a lie. If it means our families are going to be lost, we'll lie. If it means we're going to lose our standing in the community, we'll lie. It's nothing like a lying preacher, pastor, you all. I'm messing with somebody out there, and I ain't going to stay here long because I don't have time today. Some of our preacher pastors lie about how many people come to their church on Sunday. Y'all need to quit lying. Y'all, you need to stop lying. You're not impressing nobody with a lie. Nobody. And guess what? The Holy Spirit done already told us you ain't got but five. So you can quit telling us 70 people showing up at your service. We don't believe you. I don't ever challenge them, you all, because if you want to sit up and tell that kind of lie, just tell it. When I talk about this Saturday service, and I'm not just saying that because Pastor Q is with us today. When I talk about this service, including yesterday when I was at the sign shop speaking to another Christian, I always give the caveat. Some weeks I'd be there by myself. I said, but I enjoy being there by myself. I said, because it's a worship service and I enjoy the worship. I said, last week I was completely by myself because I gave the IT team the day off. And I learned, thank you, Jesus, how to run the service from my laptop, how to run the live stream and the videos and everything while I run service. So it was nobody here last week but me. But I have a viewership. Amen. Thank you all for being part of my viewership that watch this message as it's being live streamed. They watch it throughout the upcoming week. And depending on the service, it ends up being broadcast on our Monday lunch with the word service. And so I recognize that. And so when I stand up, I can have church by myself. I do it all the time. So it don't bother me to come in here and do it. So quit lying about how many people showing up. Just tell the truth. God will bless the truth. Jeez, oh, peace. We've been taught better than that. People see us stealing. They see us stealing other people's sermon. Am I messing with pastors today? Y'all, quit getting your sermons off the internet. Quit stealing other people's sermons. If God called you, he'll give you a word. And if you can't get one, then you need to question your call. I'm not questioning your call because that's between you and God. But you might need to check your call. We steal people's joy. We say words and do things that sting. We steal other people's desires to even be a Christian after they watch us clown so bad. What we say and do and think and feel, it has consequences. We gossip. We backbite. Yeah. Remember, we began this sermonic message with the premise that this text is really about love. Our love for others. And if we really loved others, we just wouldn't put our needs, especially those sinful needs, above the needs of others. Watch us Christians as we turn on those that we associate with. Those that aren't Trump supporters can't be friends with Trump supporters. Those that are Trump supporters can't be friends with almost anybody else. We need to stop it. We just need to stop it. Because that's who people see when they look at us. They see our actions and our words. That's what they see. Yeah. Corrupt, illegal. We do almost anything. A Christian that will do almost anything. That's what people see when they look at us. Never forget you all. People are watching. And because they're always watching, there are ramifications to what they see and who they see that we are. And we need to accept that and just come to terms with it. What we do does matter. Who we are does matter. And we need to keep in mind that when we fail to be attentive to the fact that we are being watched, and therefore, because we forget, we don't live according to God, the first thing we do is sin against God. And we sin against him, and that's big. But not only do we sin against God, which is problem enough, we cause those that are watching us to become discouraged. If we, the Christians, can't live for Christ, why should they even try? Remember, we supposedly know better. And they also see no reason to live in Christ. If the Christians are no different than the people in this world, why live as a Christian? Oh my goodness, you all. Politics is, I can ride that horse from here till kingdom come. They see us fighting and acting and clowning so bad. They see us saying and doing almost anything over the sake of following any people, any group of people. It's insane. We're Christians. I just wish some of us could follow God the way we follow our favorite politicians. I just wish we could. Do what he say, think what he thinks, feel what he tells us to feel. Yeah. If we can't live a life that is God-led, why would anyone in the world want to do it? We also can destroy a person by how we choose to live. Please hear this. Because of who we sometimes are and the things that we sometimes say or do, people that are watching are destroyed. They lose their faith, if they ever had any at all, because of what we said. They lose their desire to get to know our God, even if they ever had any at all, because of what we did. They lose their desire to live right, if they ever had any, because of how we're living. All because of us, you all. This is our fault. Because if we as Christians took responsibility and did what we are supposed to do, other people would follow suit. But because they know who we are and they see who we are and they see what we are, they are making the choice to go the other direction. And we hate to admit that something we could have done can cause that. We don't even like to think about it. But we can cause people to walk away from God. Woo, that's heavy. That's heavy for me as a pastor. That certainly something I say or do can cause people to walk away from God. That's why, at least for me, and I'm not putting it on anybody else, I don't talk politics from my pulpit. I pastor a 98% white congregation. I am clear that everybody in my congregation is not a Republican or a Democrat. I am clear that I may have some Green Party members and some Libertarians. I have to stand before them and preach Jesus. That's my job. That's my job. So people say, you know, she just won't talk about it. Sure won't. Not from this place. Because I recognize that people are always watching. And we need to never forget that. There are consequences to our actions, and we can actually cause somebody to walk away from the church and never return because of something we said from up here. My goodness. We already know that we suffer because of our own messy lives. And we're the ones that sin against God. And we're the ones that become discouraged and see no reason to live in Christ. We do this to ourselves. And we're the ones that are destroyed. We're the ones that may actually walk away from God. We're the ones who spirits become weak. We're the ones that relationships with God are fractured because of our actions. Yeah, we bear and we suffer for our own actions. But those consequences extend so far beyond us. We hurt others. I need us to hear this on today. We just need to do better. If the things we say, think, or do, and perhaps even feel cause others hurt, we need to not do it. And our love, as I close, our love for others is what should make us want to live right and do right. Our love for others because they see us. I know we don't like it. I know we don't want it. I know we wish it just wasn't so, but they see us, you all. They see us, and people are watching. Never forget that. My prayer is that this message resonates with every person who hears it, that people are watching. Never forget. Those of you who don't know Jesus as Savior, reach out to me. Google First Baptist Church of Tarentum, Pennsylvania. Certainly you will find a way to contact me that I might be able to share Jesus Christ with you. And not only share Jesus Christ with you, but share First Baptist Church of Tarentum. We want you to be saved. And if you're already saved, we want you to be in the midst of a loving group of people who will wrap their arms around you and help carry you into a place of being in right relationship with God. And we working at it, and we would love to have you join the team and work at it with us. Amen. Amen. I praise God for that today. Those of you that can, and if you would, stand on up. We're going to do this last selection, and we're going home. Amen and amen. There's proof, you all, in the pudding. Yes, there's proof.
My history,
when you look around and just see the sun shining, there's proof. Yes.
The winter storms,
when we woke up this morning, there was proof. Proof of what?
In every
proof of his love for us.
From where I'm standing, I see the evidence of
he's a good God, you
all over my life.
And the evidence is all over our lives. I love it. I love it. I love
I
it.
See promises
yes. Yes, we see his promises being fulfilled in our lives. Oh.
Help me remember when I'm weak.
Thank you, Lord.
Fear may come, but fear will leave.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You lead my heart to victory.
Even on those low days, and we all have them,
you are my
there's
strength.
Evidence. Of our goodness, of his goodness towards us. Amen.
I see the evidence of your goodness.
Thank you, Lord.
All over my life.
All over your life. There's evidence you are.
I see your promises.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
All over my life.
Day after day, we see it.
See the cross, the empty grave,
yes.
The evidence is endless.
The cross and the empty grave, that's evidence, you all.
Because of you,
yes.
Oh Jesus,
he continues
see the cross,
to live.
The empty grave, the evidence is endless.
He died for us, but he rose again. Yes,
you, oh Jesus,
so that we could be forgiven for our sins.
See the evidence of
thank
your
you,
goodness.
I see the evidence of your goodness.
All over my life.
All over my life, Lord.
I see your promises
you're so
in
good.
Fulfillment.
You're so gracious.
All
you're so
kind.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you give. Thank you for all that I've been blessed with. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I see promises.
Don't you see it? Don't you see his promises coming to pass in our life each and every day? To know you all, he's got us in the palm of his hands. He's protecting us, he's caring for us, he is so good to us. Amen and amen. And there's evidence Oh, let me let you go home. Let's pray our dismissal. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would be with us as we leave this place, Lord, but never your presence. That your sun would shine upon us, the S-O-N and the S-U-N. And that you would give us peace that only comes from you. Amen. In the name of Jesus, amen. And I need you all to know forever and always that I pray for you. And I ask you to please pray for me. Amen. Amen.